What's up, DigiFriends? It's Sammy here with DigiVangelism, and it has been a while since we have brought you a YouTube video. But, you know, we had coronavirus, and then, you know, some life changes, and then coronavirus. That's actually all you really need. I feel like any excuse you want to give, just kind of give COVID. And I'm really excited to come at you today wearing my Digi t-shirt, which does not actually have a Digi design on it yet, but we're getting there. We are testing some shirts, making sure that we have only the comfiest shirts that we can share and put our designs on and all that good stuff. So it's a slow process, but it's a process that we are in, and I'm just happy to be wearing it today. Do you like the logo colors? Branding. So today we are going to start off tackling a very important question that a lot of people ask, because there's so much out there to get distracted with as far as digital ministry. How do I start with digital ministry? We know it is daunting, especially if you aren't used to navigating the internet. There are so many options, even if you are used to navigating the internet. I mean, TikTok, Twitter, Twitch, like, what are all these things? I was actually scrolling through the App Store to find other apps that started with T. There are a lot that I did not recognize. And like, I'm a millennial and I'm fairly active online, so it's constantly changing. So for someone that isn't used to being online, or even not used to being online as much, where do you start with digital ministry? We're gonna help you out here today. Let's get started. If you're taking notes, this is where you write down 1, website, and after that you can write 2, Facebook. These are the places you want to focus your energy on. This is where most people are going to see your stuff. Sure, there are people on other apps, and there will always be new apps and new ways you can engage, and that's great. But if you are just getting started, and that's who this video is for, those just getting started, reminder, start with your website, start with Facebook, let us help you make them the best that they can be. First things first, website. Why have a website? Some churches don't have websites. Unfortunately, a lot of churches that do have websites don't ask themselves, why do we have this website? They just say,
oh, other people have websites, everybody has a website, we should have a website, let's just put everything we can think of on there, not even think about what it's used for. Website, 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 we're doing it now.
Not the best tactic. Okay, when you think of your website, I want you to think of your visitors. Look at your website as if you are a visitor to your church, or as if you're visiting another church and you want to see what they're about, or even just see if they are in your local area. I mean, if the amount of things that can be left out of a website that a visitor is gonna come to your website for, like they are Googling your church, it's incredible. But the worst case scenario is to not have a website at all. So make sure you do have a website, but make sure you pay attention to why you are having this website. Besides just having the information that a visitor is gonna look for on your website, you need to have that information clearly displayed and easy to find. We should not be trying to figure out what you're trying to say to just figure out where we go to get to your church. Like, what's the location here? Don't give me the GPS coordinates. I mean, at least give me something. So if that's all you're giving, that's fine. But give me something that's easy to follow. Give me a clear instruction about when your worship times are. And don't make it like in the bottom part of your website, you have to click 4 different places for me to get to it. If I'm a visitor, I'm already probably anxious about going somewhere new, and I don't want to have to hunt to find where all this important information is. So make it clear and make it easy to find. Now, you might be asking me, what type of things actually need to be on my website? Well, first, as I've said, your location really needs to be clear. We need to know where to go to get there, if we're going there. And if we're not going there, if you're online or if you're a hybrid service, please make sure that link is on there clearly, as well as any instructions. So if it's Facebook Live, maybe it's just, you know, go to this link, say hello, please comment. If it's Zoom, if there's a password or if there are any special things people need to be doing once they get in, that needs to be up there. Where to go and how to get there appropriately. And if your situation for parking is really complicated, put that on your website. I mean, like, lay it out for people, make it as easy for them as possible. Don't give them any excuse to say, yeah, never mind, not this week, that just is a little bit too much, because it's going to be easy for people to do that, especially if they're already kind of on the fence about doing this new thing, which going to a church for some people is a new thing. It's an overwhelming thing, it's an emotional thing, and so let's make it easy for people, as easy as we can. Next up, worship times. You need to not only be clear about when worship is, but also any kind of fellowship opportunities, who is that for, and when is that, and when does it actually start, and when does it actually end, and all of those things that, like, well, people just know that it starts before service, that we can hang out for a little bit and chat and whatever. No, people aren't going to know that unless you tell them. So make it clear, not only when your service starts, but when any other social activity around your service is going to be happening. Next up is your mission. Now, this is a tricky one, because for some churches, their mission is everything. Their mission is what they focus on in their meetings, in their, you know, annual planning, in every ministry that they have. They're living out their mission as a church. That's great. If your mission is just something that you, like, type up for a brochure when you print them off for an event, but you don't actually know what it is, or, you know, most people probably don't know what the mission of the church is, you probably don't, like, you don't need that on your website. If it's gonna make you feel better because you put some words up there or you think it sounds good, that's fine. But really, if you're putting your mission up there, you want it to be something that you believe in, something that you are living into as a community intentionally, because someone is going to be looking for that and potentially read that and say, that is a mission I want to get behind. So make sure that you're following it. You don't want them to show up and find out that you're not actually about the mission that you said you were anyway. You want those people that are excited about it to find that you're living it out and that they can live it out there too. Next up, the I'm new here section. This is a huge, very important piece of every church website, because a visitor is gonna have a lot of questions. And for some visitors, to have the answers to these questions is gonna be like a luxury. Like, oh, I was kinda curious about what people were gonna wear and what I should be wearing and what my kids should be doing during service and that sort of thing. For other visitors, these answers are going to be, they're gonna make or break whether these people walk in your church or whether they log on. If they don't have the answers to these questions, they will not come. Like, straight up, if I don't know what to wear, I'm gonna be a nervous wreck and I'm gonna be uncomfortable because I'm gonna either overdress or underdress and not make a good impression, or people are gonna think I'm weird or whatever. So I'm just not gonna come, it's not worth it. So, yet again, make it clear for people what is expected. And even if there's a range of attire and you don't really care what people wear, say that. Just saying it makes people breathe a little bit and feel like they have some space to move, to be themselves, to show up how they're planning to show up and be welcomed that way. Some other questions you could answer include, how long is worship? So how long a time period am I committing myself to if I walk in your door so I don't have to awkwardly walk out? What does communion look like? Church is very, like, within denominations, within smaller segments of denominations, everybody does their own thing. So if you have communion, you should, I'm gonna say should, that's a bad word, but like, you should tell people ahead of time, really. That's a tricky thing for a lot of people. So give them a heads up, what's this communion look like? What happens with my kids during worship? That's really nice to know. Or what could happen if there's an option? Do I need to do anything special when I arrive? Some churches have different stations that visitors need to visit, if they need to sign in, if they need to fill out a name tag. It's just kind of nice to give people a heads up. This is our practice. This is what you're walking into. Which door do I go in? I can't tell you how many times I've been to a church and, like, I can't figure out how to get in. Or, like, I try a couple doors and they're locked, or I try a door and I go in and there's, like, nobody. Like, clearly I chose the wrong door and I'm, like, going through back hallways and going upstairs. Tell people. Some churches actually take photos of, like, this is the entrance that you're gonna go into. This is where you're gonna go next. This is what happens in church. This is what happens in worship. This is what it looks like step by step. This is where you go for communion. It's just helpful. It gives people more than enough. And yeah, I know it seems a little excessive and you might be like, I don't have 10 hours to give to this project. Is it worth getting those people through your doors, or getting a chance to tell them that they are loved, or getting a chance to welcome them when they might not have ever been welcomed before? Next up, you want to make sure your statement of faith is on there, and whether that's a denominational statement of faith, or whether that's your own church's statement of faith, or both, just make sure it's clear what this kind of community is about. And especially if you are a Reconciling in Christ congregation or an Open and Affirming congregation, make it clear that you shamelessly welcome people of any sexual orientation or gender or race or economic status or ability, whatever it is. Just lay it out there, because our BIPOC and our LGBTQ plus individuals that are visiting churches and allies are looking for that kind of thing, and they notice it when they see it. So if that's you, make it clear, and if it's not you, don't say it's you, because that's just messy and awful, really. So be true to who you are in your statement of faith and in welcoming who you actually welcome. Giving opportunity, you are only doing a disservice to yourself and your people, which is everyone, if you don't make your giving opportunity clear. Like, make it clear, make it easy for people to follow, and as simple as possible. Like I said, you're really doing a disservice to yourself, but also everybody. So don't do that. Contact forms are great ways to make sure people know that they can reach out to you with whatever's on their mind or with whatever they need. Sometimes churches throw up their websites and make it really hard to figure out how to message anybody. Like, there's no email address. Maybe there's a phone number, but not everybody does that anymore. I know they can do that, but not everybody will. So a contact form is a really easy way for people to just shoot their, you know, email address, their name, and their question directly to maybe your office person or your pastor, for them to kind of filter who needs what from there. Regular occurring ongoing events can be put on your website. Now, my little caveat to this is, don't feel like that's where you update whether things change. If the time changes, you want to change the time of your weekly basket weaving group from 6 to 6:30, because you don't want Betty to come at 6 when it's 6:30. Good example, right? I'm really rocking those. But don't stress about making your website be the place people have to go to, like if there's snow or ice or inclement weather of any kind, or you just don't feel like having it for 2 weeks. That should not be where people are going. They should be getting connected to a leader from your website, so you could put your, like, contact this person if you're interested in attending, and then that person could kind of be the communications leader for that group, or perhaps they have their own social media or their own Facebook group or something like that. But don't be updating the website for every single week. That should really just be a place where people can go to find out that you have these ministries happening and when they are happening. Last but not least for the website, if you are recording sermons, you want to make sure those are easy to find as well. Now, that's kind of like a luxury step. Don't feel like you're missing out if you're not putting your sermons up there. But if you're going through the effort of recording the audio or the video for your sermons, the messages in your worship services, make sure people can get to them. And a website is a good place to do that. I mean, you could also put them on YouTube and just link them up, link your Facebook page, wherever you put them, just make sure people know, oh, there are sermons I can get to every week as well. Okay, I know that was a lot of information that you need to have clearly listed on your website, easy to find, and you're like, how do I do that? how do I make it all easy to find? And if you search on Google for web developers, or you are asking around for some people, like, there's a wide range of prices and just expertise out there, and just levels of complexity for your website. So I would just caution you and say your website can be basic. There it is. Website can be basic. You can get it done cheap. It's okay. It doesn't have to be the most beautiful thing. That's not gonna make or break people coming to your service or finding the love of Jesus in their life. What matters is that they know how to connect with you, and that you make that all very easy to find and clear. So basic is fine in this circumstance. It's the last thing I want to suggest here with website is that you have someone look over your website, maybe even before you go live with it. And particularly, I want you to have someone look at it that does not go to your church. Maybe they don't go to any church. And I want you to ask them, can you just think about if you would go to a church and you don't know anyone and you don't know anything, and like, it's a little, you know, maybe an overwhelming experience, and you're reading my website, what else do you need to know? What is missing that makes it unclear about what's happening or who we are? And what is confusing about what's up there? Because a lot of times church folks can just use insider language like no other. So we're talking and we think everyone knows what we mean about the theology of the cross and transubstantiation, and we're going on and we're like, yeah, we sound smart and Jesus loves us and whatever. And people are like, I have no idea what you said. And they might not even have heard the Jesus loves us part because they're so distracted about the big words that you are sharing. So keep it simple. All right, we wrapped it all up with websites. Now we're gonna go talk about Facebook. And Facebook, like, Yes, it is one of many apps, social media apps out there. I understand that not everyone is on it as much anymore, but it's still the top dog. And yes, other platforms are rising. Facebook is where we want you to go first, still. Facebook is where you should focus your energy first before doing anything else. And don't even worry about those for a while because you really want to dive in deep with Facebook. That's where people are. Let's do it. There are two different ways to use Facebook. Okay, there are a lot of ways to use Facebook. We're going to tell you about two of them. You have Facebook groups, which we'll get to. And there are pages. Now, you want to focus on both, but want to think about groups as like the living room of your church. So like people have come in and they're not only like in the foyer, the lobby, whatever, they're actually all the way back hanging out in the living room with people, getting to know one another. So this is like a private group. You can actually make it private so it's secure. It's only people in your church. And this is where people can share prayer requests with one another that they might not post on a public page. This is where people can share life updates with one another, pictures of their kids. This is where your church gets to kind of connect. And you really can foster community. As a leader in your church, you can start those conversations. You can share the updates as things happen in your church. Maybe certain meetings do something, and it's not page worthy, but you want to share it with everybody. The point of this group and groups is to build relationships, and they're a little more personal there. So be active in that group. Encourage your community to be active in that group, and don't let it just become like a place for announcements. Like, oh, this is coming up and come to worship and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Like, yeah, we have to tell people about things and remind them, I know that, but you really want to try to foster relationships in your group. Even if it's small, even if you have 5 people in that group, it's your group, it's your living room, your digital living room. So if we have a digital living room, we also need a digital front porch, and that's what our page is. The page is public. This is where you're just hanging out on the stoop and people are kind of passing by and they're trying to figure out if your community is something that they want to be involved in. And maybe they're not even trying to figure out if they want to be involved in your church. Maybe they know they don't want to be involved in your church, but they see what you're doing. They see it from the street. This is your front porch, your digital front porch. So much like your website, you want there to be information that is easy to find, easy to read. And so the best way you can do that is just to make sure your Facebook page is updated, the information. They ask certain questions, where are you located, what's your mission, all these things. When you're filling out the information for your page, just fill it out properly and make yourself a note. Maybe 6 months from now, you check back to see if everything's still the same. It's unlikely that you would forget to change if your church address changed, but maybe if, you know, digital worship, you know, changed in some way, and now you're doing a coffee hour before instead of afterward, maybe you forget to update your page, or maybe a leader changed and now there's information on there that's wrong. Just make a note to yourself to just check in with your Facebook page every 6 months to make sure it's still up to date and that people are getting the proper information when they go there. Next up, you want to use your page to provide value. Now, we say this a lot here at Digi, and a lot of people say it online, and a lot of people say it in the world. Providing value is good. And it's a lot better than using your page like a megaphone to say, hey, come hang out with Betty at the sewing ministry on this day, and then come to worship on this day. And like, you're just constantly asking people to do something. You are asking from them, when really you want to try to use most of your posts to give to them. You're not asking anything of them. In fact, you're giving to them. And it could be as simple as like a mini message. You take 2 minutes from the sermon on Sunday and you put it in a video. Or if video is not your speed, even if you put it on a picture, you type it up, it doesn't matter. You're giving people something. Maybe you give them a joke or a question, and the people give their answers to their questions, and there's like this interaction there. Maybe you just remind them that they are loved, or you give them prayer even. There's so many different ways that you can be providing value rather than asking from people all the time. And sure, you can still announce things if you need to, but like 80% of the time, you really want to try to be giving of yourself as a church. Another way that you can provide value is to share your community on your Facebook page. I mean, this is just a prime spot to give people like a sneak peek of what's happening back there in that living room. People on the porch, they might not get the full experience. You could share a video, share a story, share a testimony of how someone's life has been changed by this community or by Jesus, by God's love. You could showcase a specific ministry that week. You could ask people their opinion in a poll to make a decision, or give people a sneak peek to worship coming up on Sunday. You could even have your pastor share a little bit about their sermon prep before the Sunday comes up. You're just inviting people in with every single step you take, and that is huge because you never know who is out there watching. You never know who's standing on the other side of the street seeing what you're putting out there on your front porch, and who needed to know that they were loved that day, or who needed to hear that mini message, or even just see that, oh, churches can have fun? What? Not everybody's upbringing involved that kind of church. So share your community with your followers, with your people online. Wow, okay, that was a lot. And if you were taking notes, you probably have more than just website and Facebook written down at this point. So in closing, I just want to really encourage you, don't do this alone. Please, please. This is not about you. This is not about you being super tech pastor, super tech worker, or super tech volunteer even. This is about being church online. This is about getting the message heard to people where they actually are. And so invite people into the process. It's actually a beautiful, super fun process. So you shouldn't have trouble with that. And if you do, stay tuned, because we're gonna put out some content about how to make that a little bit easier for you. But really, you know, ask a couple people who have gifts in this sort of thing, whether it's thinking of ideas or taking pictures, or they're already on Facebook like 24/7 and you know that they'll be great for this, or just have some time on their hands. Gather these folks together and come up with a system, come up with a process, a timeline that's gonna work for you, that's gonna work for your community, and then have fun with it. I mean, just go in, all in. And you're gonna meet challenges along the way. We always, you know, run up against obstacles, but you'll get over them. It's gonna be worth it. The point is, you are reaching out. You are reaching out from your living room and into the streets and into the world. And you're gonna change lives in the process. Better get started. And that has been how you get started with digital ministry by us at DigiEvangelism. And if this was helpful for you, I hope you will like our video and subscribe for future tips. We brought the knowledge. Now it's your turn to put it into action. Peace.